Today's podcast is brought to you by WarbyParker.com. Get a free 5-day home try-on at WarbyParkerTrial.com/David Feldman Show. 5 pairs, 5 days, 100% free.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
We'll push through.
We're going to push through. This is Liam McEneaney, guest hosting David Feldman's podcast. I'm on the phone right now with Brody Stevens, who has 14% battery. He's on the road in a mall. So I'm going to keep this intro very brief. I was supposed to be a guest on David's show. And the consummate professional he is, a half hour ago, he let us know he was too sick to do it. So I'm guest hosting. I'm talking to the legendary comedian Brody Stevens. Where are you right now, Brody?
Enjoy it. Yes, I'm here in the mall, Bellevue, Washington.
Bellevue, Washington. That place must be crazy town, right?
Oh, it's happening. It's actually a really nice mall, and it's high end. It's a little too high end,
What do you mean by a little too high end?
The stores are very expensive. It's kind of it's sanitary here.
Right.
There's a lot of money. It's a lot of Microsoft money, a lot of Amazon money. So the stores are, you know, they're nice but there's not, I wouldn't say there's a whole lot of character. I think back in the day, Bellevue had a little more character. Not that the east side here in Seattle, the suburbs, were ever like known for, you know,
right,
being like Seattle downtown, but I think it's like it's lost its feel a little bit. That's all.
Now you're on the, I mean, that's the thing people don't understand is I tell them when you're on the road, you spend a lot of time just walking around malls looking at people.
Yeah, malls are, you know, malls, you know, it's a great place to see people. You know, if you're a comedian, just to be in a controlled environment, not that, you know, you're getting, you see people, you got a food court.
Right. Now what,
Liam?
Yes,
I'm getting a call from my agent.
Okay,
I'm going to let this go through because we're podcasting. I'm getting a call from my agent, but you are more important right now, and I probably just lost
which
$100 gig.
Which agency are you with? Century 21.
That's very funny.
Brody hates when I make those kinds of jokes. I've known Brody for 20 years, and Brody, you actually like. It's funny. I'm moving to LA in a week. And
what, you are?
I am. I'm moving to Los Angeles. And
cool. You got that job at Jersey Mike's?
I hate to brag. I'm at Jamba Juice.
Oh, nice. Well, you know, they have better. You can benefits. I think they have benefits at Jamba Juice. You get a free boost every drink you get.
No, I mean, it's funny, like... Because I'm moving without a job. I don't have a job. I just, like, have decided to go. And I remember, like, 10, 11 years ago, you did the same thing. You just were like, New York isn't happening for me anymore. I'm just going to go back to Los Angeles because you're from the 818. You're from Tarzana. You represent the Valley.
I certainly do. Yeah, well, when I began my trek into comedy, when I said, hey, I got to try and make it, felt like... You know, I had to leave L.A. I grew up in Los Angeles, but I played baseball in college at Arizona State, you know, so I never really did. I didn't start comedy until I was done with college.
Right.
And so I was back in Los Angeles, flat-footed, essentially, trying to figure out. I knew that I wanted to try entertainment.
Right.
So I did 3 years, and I just knew to get out of L.A. I just knew right away, like, having, it's so big, it's so spread out, and if you don't have anything going on, it's a really difficult place to start.
Right.
The open mics and all that. So I left. I mean, my mind, I always wanted to, I knew I needed to leave, and it was either, so I went, ended up in Seattle. That's where I'm at today, right now. But I had 3 years in Seattle, 3 years in New York, and I felt, I always had a plan to get back to Los Angeles when I was 30.
Right.
So I knew I had the year 2000 in my head, like, okay, I'm going to go away for 6 years and really train myself, make myself, get it ingrained in my brain as a performer, as a comedian. So I did didn't do any baseball stuff. Just did 3 years in Seattle, 3 years in New York, and then
Now, when
started working in L.A. You know, so
when you said baseball stuff, you were doing baseball in college.
Well, I played baseball all through college. You know, I played baseball at Arizona State, so right. I was always into that. And then my last year in college, I took an acting class because I had extra credits and I was kind of done playing. My arm was all not working properly. And people said, "Hey, Brody, you're funny." And I always thought about maybe doing something like that.
Right.
So I did the class and it was really, you know, I was love at first sight. So I did that. And then when I started comedy, I just like did all out comedy. And I knew that I had to just go away and train myself. So 3 years in Seattle, 3 years in New York. And then, you know, our friends started moving to LA and I knew. Because I would hear stories of people going to Los Angeles. Oh, I can't get on stage. Or, oh, I don't know how to get around. Or I'm lost.
Right.
For me, I mean, I know that I went along. I mean, I know when you said, like, you're moving to L.A. without a job or, you're going. You're really not. You're right. Going out there based off you have these friends.
Right.
You have these relationships. You have the confidence and you have the connections. When I went back to L.A., I knew I had a place to stay.
Right.
I knew I had a car. I knew how to get around. I knew that I had friends like Alex Sulkin and John Goldblatt and all these guys working on TV shows. So I felt like I was connected to them in some way.
But also I remember you were up at Luna Lounge and Patton Oswalt was closing out the show. And after the show, he came up to you and he's like, "Oh my God, you are amazing." I was standing right next to you and he was like, "You know, next time you want to go, there's this show out there. It was called Comedy Death Ray at the time. Now it's called Comedy Bang Bang." And he's like, "Anytime you're in L.A., just hit me up. Here's my number, and I'll get you on Comedy Death Ray, no problem." So you had stuff like that going for you, too.
Yeah, well, exactly. That gave me confidence. I remember that moment. I remember when Patton came up to me. I think it was Largo, maybe, he may have said. I think it was Largo.
No, it was Luna. It was Luna. Oh, Largo. I'm sorry.
No, we did Luna Lounge in New York. But Largo was the room out in Los Angeles. So I knew when I came out to L.A. that Patton was somebody who would, put a word in for me.
Right.
So that was a big moment. All doing those that Monday night show, everybody knew, like, that was the show to be on in terms of, I mean, think of all the shows. That was a spot you wanted to do, that Luna Lounge on Monday nights.
Right.
And when I did it, like Todd Barry, I did it like four times. And when I did it with Todd Barry, I did it with Dave Chappelle, Mark Maron, Janine Garofalo, I said to myself, "Look, I'm holding my own with these guys. I'm doing it. And then I have friends in LA. I want to go back to LA. I'm kind of feeling it. It's that 2000. That's why I made the leap." But
I mean, you're always a fucking powerhouse on stage.
Well, thank you, but I didn't feel it until, those last few times, like at Luna Lounge in there, and then also doing my show on Monday nights at Eureka Joe, the Festival of Laughter.
Right.
I was able to kind of spread my wings hosting, and, you would help me with that show. You took that show over, and that I felt, it was like a booked open mic, and I would do my 15-minute State of the Union comedy speech up front for all the comedians. And we had some audience members sometimes. And then the show would start. And I would remember that, I'd have to shuffle the lineup to, like, make sure the show goes. It was a free show on Monday night in the Flatiron District, you know? So I got to keep the audience. We had dollar beers. But I would, mix in the comedians. I always felt like I was a manager. Doing this, picking guys up, playing music, interacting. It was guys like, you helping Victor Varnado and Colton Dunn and Leonard. And
right. Oh, Leonard. You know. Tell people who Leonard was. Leonard Ben-Hire.
Leonard was at the time, a 78-year-old Jewish
garden
comedian, open micer from Brooklyn.
Right.
And he was just full of, positive energy, loved to laugh and dance and move around. And he drove a big Cadillac. And he was 78 at the time, and he would come to the show every Monday night and be supportive. I'd bring him up. Here he comes.
Yeah, you were like a walking Howard Stern show. Like, you just always had this like a crew of characters in your orbit.
Yeah, but you know, but it's, you want to be nice to him. You know,
right.
It's never like being mean to him. Leonard really liked it. You never like making fun of the guys.
Right.
You know, it's always like finding the best in people. And yeah, you don't want to be cruel. I kind of like got that out of my system, like doing my silly show up in Seattle.
Right. With Tana Maru and.
With Tana, you know, we were young and young and silly. And
right.
I was doing some, I just, you know, you just don't want to be mean to, and plus Howard Stern did all that. I kind of didn't want to be like Howard Stern watching too much of that.
Right.
You know, that's why I don't watch a lot of comedy or watch too much of something. You start, you know, thinking like it somewhat too. If you watch too much of the same people, you start sounding like them.
Right. And that's like, you know, like comics who started in New York. When we started, all sounded like Dave Attell, myself included.
Yeah. Everybody would watch Dave Attell. Then it's like everybody would watch Mitch Hedberg. Everybody is watching Brody Stevens. You got it. Yes. You know, everyone goes through those phases. So it's either watch a lot of comedians.
Right.
But if you start watching the ones you really like Louis C.K. or whatever, you're going to start, you know, sound like them. And I'm fearful of that. At times.
Do you find a lot of like Brody imitators? A lot of comics who sound like Brody?
I see it, but I take it as a, you know, I see it, some of it, but
you should do a show
as an homage.
You should do a show in the belly room at the Comedy Store where it's just you and all the Brody imitators. Just like,
I think we had something like that before.
Have you?
We may have had shows like that before, yeah. The moments like that. I mean, for me, it's like I'm not tired of it. I'm just used to it. Like, people go through their Brody phases. Yes, enjoy, push.
Right.
You know, they go through it, or they'll actually, you know, do that for audience warm-up. They'll just freaking, like, they'll assume my personality for warm-up because it works. It's a cheerleader guy, you know? But
you're a master at audience warm-up.
Well, thanks. I'm a master at, I think, basic cable daily audience warm-up.
Right.
You know, when you're working with a crew every day and you're working with the same host every day, you got to keep it fresh. You got to keep it, you know, that's what I was good at, because you not only when you're doing audience warm up, let's say you do a daily show like I did Chelsea lately, or I did At Midnight most recently, and I've done over 3,000 TV shows.
Right.
You know, not only are you trying to get the crowd fired up and do a good job, but the crew guys are there too. You know, they don't hear the same stuff every day. Make it fun for them. Make it fun for the producers. Make it fun for the people on the floor. Give everyone a shot in the arm. It's not just about getting the audience hyped, doing your same cornball stuff every day. It's about getting the audience hyped, getting them to laugh,
right,
getting them to be present in the moment, and also the crew guys. You know, they you don't want to bore them. That's my opinion. You know, you can really push and try to create, or you can play it safe. You can play it safe and probably be successful,
right,
make money, have a show that lasts, but it's really not going to make a difference. My opinion.
So you go for 100% coverage, like not just the audience. You go for everybody. You want the janitor in the back laughing. You want the security guard in the booth laughing. Like, you want, from the moment you walk into the lot to the moment you leave, you just want 100% laughter.
Well, no, I don't want them to laugh. These are like, when the crew guys come up to you, that's like at the end of the week kind of thing, or like
right,
every couple weeks. Those are just like, they like it when, Brody, we like when you're here. You can tell. My goal is not to make the crew laugh. My goal is to be, have the best audience, to make sure the audience is laughing and connected with the
right
show, bringing energy for the show, for the comedians, for the host, for that.
Well, that's interesting. It's just like, because a lot of comics are about just killing as much as they can, and, you know, like picking, like the rest of everybody else can pick up the scraps, you know?
Like, I mean, Are you talking about stand-up, or?
I'm just talking about people, like, comedians are generally pretty selfish that way. Like, they want all that positive energy for themselves. And, like, you know, like, so sometimes you'll get a show where it's just, like, there's not that much energy left over, you know?
Well, what do you mean? You're saying, like, a comedian before soaks up all the positive energy, so when the next guy goes up, it's gone?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's up to the comedian. That's life. That's part of being a comedian. It's up to you to, all right, get it going.
Right.
You know, it rejuvenates.
But I'm saying, I'm saying you're the opposite, where you're like, you want to create an environment where everyone succeeds.
Well, when I'm doing warm-up, right. I think when I'm doing warm-up, yes. And I think in life, I want everybody to succeed. I'm kind of an uplifting guy. It's just, you want success. You want to see people do well. I want to see, you know, records broken. I want to see new people doing new things, inspiring people.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. When you're doing warm up, I'm trying to raise everybody. But when I'm doing stand up, I mean, yeah, it's you and the audience. It's not about the comedian before you or the comedians after you. You know, you're professional. You don't want to go over your time, and also you don't want to, like, throw off a room.
Right.
In terms of, like, being selfish and give me that energy. F yeah.
Now, the producer here, Brab Brewy, he saw you in L.A. What was it, last week, Alex? A couple weeks ago, he saw you at the Comedy Store, 11:30 in the... Now, is the original room, is that the smaller room, or is that the big room?
The medium room.
All right, that's the medium. So he saw you in the medium room, 11:30. He said...
Yes, that's the all-around workout room, yeah.
He said it was really bad. He said... No, I'm kidding. He said it was great. But that's like, I've seen you.
Be negative there for sure. Go ahead.
No, he said he saw you. I mean, I'm not trying to, like, kiss your ass on this podcast. I just he said he saw you, and he said he said you killed. Did you say he killed, Alex? What would you say? Yeah, I can't hear
fine.
You. You don't have a mic.
All right, I did fine. Okay,
you well, did listen. Great. He said you did great. He said it was like okay. watching you in your element. You know. Because you're engaging the audience.
I'm glad you... I was holding my breath. I thought you were going to say I did okay or I could have done this. Yes. Yes. The Comedy Store is... You know, I get the spot. I get spots there if I can get, you know, 2 to 3 spots a week. I'll take it. I'll take that. So imagine if I got more spots.
Right.
But... I think it's just like anything. If you get thrown up there enough, you're going to get comfortable. You're going to be in your element, comfortable. Yes. Same with, like, doing audience warm up. I've done 3,000 shows. Put me on a basic cable comedy thing. I got it.
Right.
You know, doing the road here, I don't do it all the time. It's a pattern. It's a rhythm. It's reps. The last time I went on the road like I am here in a weekend was back in April.
Uh-huh.
So I really haven't done it. So I'm a little, that's what, 4 or 5 months ago.
Right.
So I'm a little out of my element, slightly stressed, whatever. And that goes for stand up. You know, it's like, I'm lucky I get those spots at the Comedy Store. I'm lucky I just get this, you know, it's putting the time in. There really isn't a shortcut for stand up. We know that it's putting the hours in, it's getting the reps. And then if you're lucky, getting quality stage time.
Right.
Ideally, you want to get to that quality stage time.
Now, how does a comic like Brody Stevens, who's fresh to L.A., how does he get past at the Comedy Store?
Well, a part of that was doing those shows in New York, because I did Luna Lounge.
Uh-huh.
And Naomi and Jeff and Joanne, they worked at Comedy Central.
Right.
So Luna Lounge was booked by executives who had Comedy Central jobs.
Right.
So when I went out to L.A., I knew I was going to be on – I knew I'd be on Premium Blend. I had a feeling I was going to get on that. I think I did. Anyway, so
– Yeah, we did the same year.
I got on Premium Blend, and then so it's a TV credit. And then I also – because Sulkin and all these guys were at Craig Kilborn, I'd send them tapes, they knew me, boom, I got on the Late Late Show. So in the year 2000, when I moved to L.A., I knew I was going to get on Kilborn, or I had a feeling.
Right.
I knew I was hoping I'd get maybe a Comedy Central Premium Blend, I don't know. And I got those right away, and those got me past the clubs. And then based off that, I got an audition at the Comedy Store, And I think I did it once and Mitzi passed me right away. And I didn't have to go through, I was so lucky. I didn't have to go through, you know, the torment of like coming back week after week. Bobby Lee liked me.
Right.
The very funny Bobby Lee, he saw me somewhere and, he told me to come down to the Comedy Store and he got me a audition on a Sunday night and I got passed. Mitzi liked me. That was back in 2000. So I kind of got in right away. And then same thing with the other clubs, because I had a TV credit, like Nick Swartzen recommended me at the Improv. So that helped.
Right.
So, and then also Patton helping with Largo and then later on doing stuff with Zach help, but I was already doing things before that. So, you know, comedians are great. You know, I think they're really supportive.
You got,
so they like you, they can help you, and that's always nice.
You got hooked in with Zach Galifianakis. That's who you were talking to about, Zach. And you did. You were in a couple of his movies.
Yeah, yeah, he was in a couple of my movies. Three. We did three together. Three buddy movies.
It's great hanging out with Brody. Like, you'll go to Starbucks and they'll just tell the counter lady, like, I was in The Hangover. And you'll start like doing your dialogue from The Hangover.
That's not true. That's the thing, Liam.
You did that. Guy.
I probably did that. I did that for you. That's the thing.
Well, that's what
thing.
I'm saying.
I have to protect this on a podcast.
It was fun hanging out with you because you did that. I'm not like,
okay.
It's not a put down.
I know that, but I understand. But I have to fight because people listen to this podcast. David Feldman's a good guy. He's funny, smart people. They're going to think that I walk into Starbucks and do my lines. I don't do that. I may have done that the one time for you, possibly. But that's one thing I kind of, people think like, oh, he's always on. He's always high energy. No, I'm not. I'm actually shy. And I don't walk around telling people I'm in a movie. But I also know that show business, when you look at somebody's flyer coming to a show or somebody has an intro from, you know, from Daniel Tosho, from Kroll, from The Hangover, you know, all I'm doing is promoting myself.
Well, of
because
course.
I don't have a poster. But I don't walk into Starbucks doing my line. I'm very shy. But if specifically somebody, you know, for something, yeah, maybe I'd goof around and do it. But I'm not that guy because I think people feel like, oh, you must be a riot to hang out with. You're always like that. No, I'm not.
You're not always a riot to hang out with, but you are a blast when you're feeling it. You are a blast to hang out with.
I'm a Gemini. Yes, I'm a Gemini. I can be funny.
You can be a lot of fun.
On.
You can be on. We once drove around LA in your car. You were drumming on the steering wheel. We went to barbecue.
I remember.
You had your car cleaned. That was a fun day. It was interesting to see you because, like, I knew you from New York. That was the first time I'd come to LA. We hung out for a day. And I was like, wow, Brody is really in his element in Los Angeles. Like, this is a guy who, like, some people, they go to LA and you see them and they're, like, just kind of miserable because they have to be there to work, but they, you know, like, because they want the money, but they don't like the lifestyle. But you're a guy who's 100% about the lifestyle.
Yes, I like the lifestyle. I like the weather. I like the mountains. I like the topography. I like most of the people. You know, there are good people in LA when you can find them, but you know, there's a lot of, you know, riffraff now, like just people flocking there for different reasons. But you know, LA gets a bad rap.
I agree.
But when you're there, you can find your people. You can find your way. You can find your like-minded types. You can find your art. You can find your, so, and plus, I mean, I grew up there. I was born there in the San Fernando Valley,
right.
You know, so I just have a natural connection with there, you know, in the being there. So I like the weather. I like that I can it's peaceful.
Uh-huh.
I don't like the craziness of Hollywood. Like during the afternoon, it's just the horn honking and desperation. You know, you go out to the valley, so you can breathe.
Right.
And then you're still 15 minutes from Hollywood at night. You know, I can get to the Comedy Store in 15 minutes.
Now, do you still have like all the porn girls living in the valley? Is that still a thing?
They're all around. Yeah. They're all over L.A.
Because I think there are more beautiful women in New York than Los Angeles, based on my experience.
I think New York There's more, a lot of models there.
Uh-huh.
You know, print models. You see them on the N and the R train, of course.
Of course.
I would say that, you know, out in New York, you know, it's densely packed. They're just jammed in there. So you might see them. I think they're both. You get both.
Right.
I think New York, I think Montreal has beautiful girls. I think Miami has beautiful girls. I think Seattle has beautiful girls.
Right.
I think Phoenix has beautiful girls. I think, you know, there's a lot of pretty people out there. And, but New York is, you know, I'm so glad I spent time in New York. And I think for you to come out to LA to finally make this, I mean, you're ready for it. You've done your training.
I'm not sure if I'm emotionally ready for it, but professionally, I should have come out like 10 years ago. I mean, that's just the fact. But you know, I'm doing it now, and it's the right time for me. Are you? Now, here's my question: what's the dating scene like in Los Angeles?
I don't even know. I don't even try.
Really?
No. I mean, yes, really. I'm not. I don't think I have testosterone anymore. I can't deal with the drama. I can barely take care of myself.
Right.
You know, and I can't deal with guilt or those. Maybe I'm not finding the right girl. Maybe I'm not putting myself out in the right, you know, situations. But again, I'm a 46-year-old single, blue-collar Jewish Gemini male. And I have to do a lot of things on my own. And
right.
It's hard to relax. And I also have an opportunity, you know, through doing my periscopes, and I have to prepare for my stand-up shows. And there's a lot of, I'm not saying that a girl or, a dating wouldn't relax me and help me. And maybe, I don't know, maybe it would. But
I know for me, it's just tough to have, like, to invite a woman into my life like that, because there's so much going on where there's just, like, always this anxiety about my career, always this, like, uncertainty about where I'm going to be next, all this, like, you know, like, just for me, there's a lot of, like, emotional instability and uncertainty. And it's hard for women to kind of, like, thrive in that environment.
Exactly. Exactly. I'm, you know, I don't know what's going on. I don't know where I'm going to be in a year from now. I don't have my house. I'm not all set up. I don't have my Emmys. I'm freaking scratching.
Right.
And crawling. I've always been scratching and clawing. I can't sit back and relax. It's rare. And when I do am relaxed, I kind of like, okay, I want to jump back in and push. And, you know, like I said, I'm a Gemini. I'm sensitive. It's a hard business. And I don't want to. I mean, honestly, I don't want to have a heart attack. I don't want to have stress. Stress kills.
Right.
And I enjoy periscoping, meeting, helping people. I'd rather inspire, but that's what I'm into right now, and in helping people. But yeah, I mean, of course, I wish I had a girlfriend or a girl I was attracted to who would be attracted to me, but it was never that case. It was never that case. So instead, I just shut it down, and I'm on Brazzers. I do a lot of online pornography.
It's great, Pornhub. We're not sponsored by anybody, but X Hamster is a good one if you like just the down and dirty porn.
But I don't even do that, to be honest. I mean, I don't even, my mind's not on it. I feel like this world is so, everything's so backwards. It's like I've become like, you know, I'm going to live in the woods by myself. No, I'm playing. But, you know, it is a kind of crazy. It's just an undertaking I can't. It's like, imagine having kids. You know, imagine having that pressure.
Right.
And having to be in the position that we're in right now, doing podcasts in a mall.
Right. I mean,
you know, we don't have a pension plan.
Right.
We don't have crazy benefits. what do we have? So what do we have? I mean, unless you want to struggle with some girl, let's do the struggle together, or you get some girl who's made it, and I don't know. It's just, I'm not being negative. I just keep pushing positive. I get more. It's the best I can do.
The best comedian relationships always seem to be where the comedian does his or her thing, and then they're like married to someone who's a professional who actually makes money. you know, and so that's kind of like what your retirement plan is, like just trusting that you're with someone who has their shit together.
Yeah.
But it's tough to sell a woman who has her shit together on this lifestyle is the problem. You know,
yeah, I mean, if you want to call it a lifestyle, I mean, what, traveling around doing shows or getting up on a mic or going out late at night in L.A.? Is that that's the lifestyle?
But you're someone I consider to be successful. You had a TV show, like you had your own TV show on Comedy Central. It was about you. You had a special. You work constantly, which is like something that 99% of comedians don't do. Like with the warm-up stuff, like, and all the other stuff you do in comedy, you make a living, and 99% of comedians can't put together a living.
Well, yes.
Or maybe 95%.
I've been lucky to work in Hollywood for 15 years.
Right.
I've had a 15-year run, but they're not like major high-paying gigs. They're not major network gigs. These are chip-away, battler accumulation gigs. And yes, I would say I'm successful. People know my name. But am I raking in the money? Am I getting? No, I'm not. No, I'm not.
Not yet.
I don't know. Not yet. I don't know. Not ever. Who knows? But people go, you're successful. Yeah, I know that I invested in myself. I went all out. I didn't nickel and dime it.
Right.
I was towards being the best comedian I can be, just like I tried to be the best pitcher I could be. And I made it to Arizona State, where I won 3 games and pitched 25 innings. And I got everything out until my arm fell off. I got everything out of audience basic cable warm-up.
Right.
I got everything out of hosting shows. I got everything out of doing late. I mean, I think I've squeezed everything out. But there comes a point where there's diminishing returns.
Right.
Where you got to work smart, you know? Like, hey, Brody, maybe if you, instead of buying a $100 pair of shoes, if you gave, you know, an intern $100, that person can help you out and get things done, you know? So you got to be smart with that type of stuff.
You gotta. I mean, and you know, like you, like it's all about, I mean, you have a lot of friends who are in powerful positions too. I mean, you know, it's like you have a really good, friendship network out there.
I do, but that still doesn't mean they're not going to stop you from sleeping in your car.
Yeah. But
I don't know. I'm not saying that's going to happen, and I'm being negative with that. But I also, I mean, I spent, you know, 10 years doing this warm-up stuff, putting my energy into that. And, yes, I've met all these contacts and, you know, built up a good, you know, following with on that side of the camera. But
right.
Now it's the last 5 years is like taking, it's, I'm the guy. They're not, oh, I'm not the warm up guy that took them by surprise. It's like, we're here to see Brody.
Right.
So you have to like change. It's new to me. I don't not like it, but it's new to me when they expect it. And then when you have, you know, big crowds expecting it, or, oh, let's see what this guy, he's popular. Let's see what he's got. I don't know him, but I've heard about him. You know, that's the part of like getting the new audiences members. I was never the class clown. I was never a guy who loved crowds.
Right.
You know, it's funny to my people. And then the more popular you get with comedy, you get more people coming out. So like every show you go out on the road, it's like you got to like not, I feel like I pick up on people like with their arms crossed negative. Who is this guy? Or they're not laughing or they don't get it. And I feel like my back's against the wall and I got to explain to them. And then I end up getting worked up. It's like not fun. You're working as opposed to like being yourself.
Right.
And you know, I have that going through my head.
And you get,
and that's not fun.
You get in your head. And it's hard. It's hard to be funny when you're in your head, you know?
Yeah, it's hard to be funny when you're in your head. It's hard to be funny when, you know, you're in your head and you haven't eaten properly. You're not on a regular schedule. You've got, you know, you've got so many things going on. People don't understand how difficult comedy is.
Right.
And, you know, but again, it's having the jokes.
Right. You have jokes.
You know, we could, well, I have jokes, but it's about accessing those jokes, Rolodexing those jokes, you know, sitting there and breathing so you can remember and relax. It's like test taking, you know, some people get nervous taking a test or, and they forget, they can't, they don't do well. You got to be able to thrive under those pressure situations. But if you, it's not pressure. If you, I mean, I'm never feeling pressure doing warm up. I don't feel pressure doing periscopes.
Right.
I don't feel pressure drumming. I'm having fun.
Right.
But when you're doing the road and they're coming in, it's this every week. It's like, I, that to me is pressure. Well, it's pressure because Brody, welcome to work. Welcome to the real world.
Right.
So then you say to yourself, okay, how can I be most productive? You know, you're supposed to follow what you like, what you're good. Well, usually what you're good at, you like.
But I mean, you have a, so you, well, let me ask you this. So you're in Bellevue, Washington. I'm guessing you're performing at the Parlor.
I have two shows tonight. Yep. 8 and 10.
Two shows at the Parlor. Who are you opening for?
That's funny.
No, but I mean, you have these crowds, like it's a hometown crowd too. Like these,
I would say there's some home crowd, benefactors, yeah, a little bit.
Do you have people coming out who remember you from, like, the Brody and Tana show?
There's a handful, yeah. I would say I'd have about, say about 30 to 40, 35% of the audiences know me.
Right. And what are the other audiences? Like, what is the rest of the percent? Like, just people who are coming for comedy?
Coming for comedy, yes. Coming for comedy, maybe they've seen me on Chelsea lately.
Right.
Maybe they recognize my face or coming for comedy, and the other half are fans or the other third or whatever.
What is your line from The Hangover?
My line, so I walk in, I'm one of the police officers giving the kids a tour of the station.
Right.
So I walk in, Zach is, they're handcuffed to a bench, it's Zach, it's Bradley Cooper and the guy from The Office.
Right.
I come in, they're handcuffed to a bench, I'm a police officer giving kids a tour of the police station. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Officer Foltz, and this is The Hangover. Background, speeding, lights, sound, action. So after we take their mugshots, we bring them on down here where they wait to be interviewed by the arresting officers. Trust me, kids, you don't want to be sitting on these benches. We call this place Loserville. Follow me. Yes, and that, my friend, is the scene.
Anything you got coming up you want to promote, Brody?
I will be in Scottsdale, Arizona this coming week. So I'm going from Bellevue, Washington to Scottsdale, Arizona. So uh-huh. This weekend, that's where I'll be. And then 2 weeks after that, I will be in Washington, D.C.
Wait, hold on. What's the club in Scottsdale you're going to be performing at?
Stand-up Scottsdale.
Stand-up
Scottsdale.
Scottsdale. Come see Brody Stevens there. October, and then where else are you going to be? Washington, D.C.?
I'm going to be at the Draft House in D.C.
Oh, very hip.
Somewhere.
That's a very hip venue.
I'm doing some very hip stuff recently.
Marina Franklin was at the Draft House recently.
Oh, she's a bartender there?
Marina's blowing up, man.
I know.
She's doing real good, actually.
I keep track of her. I keep track of everybody.
She's too busy to hang out with me. That's all I know.
She doesn't come out to L.A. very much, though.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, I mean, when you're in New York, you don't really, I mean, it's just such a pain to fly out there and then.
And I didn't say, I'm not saying that in a negative way.
Right.
I'm saying she's known as like a New York. Like Nikki Glaser's moved to L.A. You know, she was New York. Now she's L.A.
Is she really? She's in L.A.? Because like.
I think so.
Amy Schumer's keeping it New York.
Amy Schumer's not, is still New York.
She's still New York.
Sarah is L.A.
Sarah's L.A. Feinstein. Rachel Feinstein's a New Yorker.
Lisa Lampanelli is New York still.
Right.
Some people haven't, you know, some people are, Louis might be half and half.
Right.
Zach is L.A.
Zach is L.A., but I heard he doesn't drive.
Since when? Really?
That's the rumor. That's what someone.
Zach?
That's what a friend of ours told me, was that Zach doesn't really drive.
Anymore or back then?
This was last year. This is what he told me.
He used to always, I mean, you're saying he stopped driving?
I don't know. I was just talking to a friend. He's like, Zach doesn't really drive.
I'm going to find out.
Okay.
You used to drive everywhere.
This is just strictly what someone else told me.
I'll find out if that's true.
I don't know Zach, obviously, the way you do. I mean, I know him, but I don't know him the way you do. Like, you two...
Well, you know, people change. Maybe he doesn't drive anymore. Is that breaking news? Because I'm going to tweet it.
Feel free to tweet it. Just leave my name out of it, man.
You got it.
So, Brody, you're going to be at the Alamo Draft House in a few weeks in October.
Yep.
Brody Stevens, star of The Hangover and Due Date, and also the Brody Stevens is your show is available on
iTunes and on Amazon.
I watched
people
it on Amazon
like
Prime.
It's critically acclaimed.
It's got a following. And do you get a chunk of money whenever someone like buys or rents it?
I don't think so.
All right, then forget it. We don't need to waste our breath on those kinds of things. And of course you can see Brody in Los Angeles, and you'll be able to see me in Los Angeles. And we'll be doing all kinds of shows together, I think. I mean, not when I hit town.
That?
We'll do shows together. Not when I hit town, but...
Well, I don't do many, you know.
Right.
You know me.
Right. You don't do shows at UCB or, you know, like you do the big shows.
Yeah, I'm doing big stuff. You know, like Beacon Theater. I do...
Oh, yes, I do... I outgrew the Beacon Theater.
Yeah, I'm doing shows over at the Tappan Zee Bridge. No, I don't know. I don't know.
Well, you can see Brody this weekend on Venice Beach doing a show. In a drum circle. selling some of that good kush.
You got it. Selling it and embracing it.
Listen, Brody, thanks for taking a minute out of your time in Bellevue, Washington. To talk to us. I cannot recommend this enough. If you have a chance to see Brody live in your area, run, don't walk to your computer and buy like 20 tickets for you and your friends.
Show up.
And then don't show up. But pay the money so Brody gets the money, but don't go.
Yeah.
That's the way to do it.
You know,
whenever I'm getting paid to do a show, like at a club or on the road or something, I always sit there and watch the audience go in and pray for like a bomb threat or something so that I still get paid, but I don't actually have to do the show.
Well, let's keep it positive. You got to get that out of your head.
We
have to stay positive.
We have to stay positive. KIP, keeping it positive with Brody Stevens.
Keep it positive. Yes. Keep it positive. Let's go.
Positive
push,
energy.
Push, push,
push,
push, push, push.
Can you say positive energy for the people?
Positive energy. We finish on strong imagery. Yes, no bomb threats. Let's go.
All right, Brody. Thanks so much. I'll see you soon.
Okay, Liam. Looking forward to it.
All right, brother. Me too. Have a good one.